Sir, on child labour particularly, the policy earlier, the draft which was announced, you had a couple of issues and concerns on this, and later you said that some of your suggestions were incorporated. Is the draft now, robust enough in your sense?
The law has been passed by the parliament, of course, but there were lacunae in it.
Yes.
So now these issues are addressed in the rules. So the rules associated with the law are very good. If we are able to enforce them properly, then we can definitely end child labor.
In that sense, sir, are the states doing enough then? You know, if it is only about implementation right now, in your assessment, are the states doing enough?
We need to do much more. Wherever I go, the chief ministers or the labor ministers speak highly to end child labor and all this, but it should be internalized, it should be brought in priority. There is a need of much more serious political will. And in Delhi, when Government of India has launched this program, Pencil, which is very, very good program actually, this is a platform where people can make complaint and the complaints have to be monitored regularly. And disposal has to be time bound and so on. So that's a very powerful thing. And a new SOP has been also launched by the government. So it was for the first time in 37 years of my struggle against child labor in India and globally also. In India, first time, almost all major states, labor ministers were present just on one thing, and that is ending child labor. And the first time the home minister of country came and supported it. It brings much more weight in it. Because I've been demanding that only labor ministers cannot do it.
Right.
Not in India, nowhere. It should be the prime minister. It should be the president. It should be the finance ministers, the home ministers. They should come forward as a heavyweight political leaders to say no to child labor. And this time Rajnath Singh ji did it.
Sir, the major cause of child labor or even trafficking is linked to poverty, is linked to the economic conditions of where these children and these families come from. You've right now covered almost 6,000 kilometers across India, various states you've visited. How do you see the economic conditions at the grassroots level? We've had major economic setbacks in the last 1 year. If we look at that section of the population, demonetization and now GST both have somewhere broken the backbone of the unorganized sector, which is where all these families come from. They're, most of them are now unemployed. So what is your sense? What have you felt and picked up from the ground?
Well, it's true that for time being, some of the majors have affected India's economy, which one can know through the present growth rate, which has declined from last year, the first quarter, as all of us know. But I think that this is not going to remain permanent. And we cannot see the impact on children within 3 months or 6 months of downfall of economy. Let us wait for it. But definitely, the good news is that the poor people, the ordinary people, are more committed to send their children to schools.
Okay.
In spite of all this, I've seen it everywhere that people wanted to send their children to school and not to work if they can afford. But of course, we have to make all possible.
But do they have the option to send them to school and not to work?
I think if the government schemes are properly enforced with priority, with political will, and with the seriousness at the ground level, I am sure that it will help in bringing most of the children to school. For example, we have midday meal scheme, we have Manrega scheme, we have so many other schemes, and there is a need of coordination and cooperation between various ministries, various departments, which is unfortunately not happening. There should be more integrated approach to deal with the children in India, from the top level to bottom or bottom to top, which is still missing. The policies are fragmented, the programs are fragmented. So we have to see that how we can bring children in the center stage, where we can plan with much more visionary way. We can plan long term, because if you have your policy for next 5 years or next 2 years, then of course it will impact probably positively. But when you plan keeping a child in center,
right,
then it would be much more long-term policy and it will affect the entire generation.
Right, sir. Sir, but the economic, the economic setback for, let's say, the smaller section of society, the lower section of society, who are largely unskilled laborers, the moment something like a demonetization puts them out of job, and the first thing that goes out as far as expenditure is concerned is education for children, put them out of school, because we cannot afford as of now. In that regards, how do you see the government needs to plan?
Well, the government has to be committed to its own constitution. And the constitutional right and guarantee is that every child has to receive good quality education. Not just education, but quality education.
But do you think the government has...
So the government has to spend enough money on it.
Is it spending?
Budgetary
that was
allocation.
My question.
So my simple answer, which I've been telling every time to everyone, that please spend more money. Mm. Please enhance budgetary allocations for children. Mm. For education, for safety and protection, as well as for health. Mm. As I said before, that if India spends only 3.5% on health, education and protection for 40% of its population, and that is children, then we cannot achieve many things. We cannot achieve many of those social targets and the development goals which we are committed for, globally and nationally both.
Sir, how do you see migration as an issue here? Because when employment opportunities are scarce in rural population, we've seen obviously them migrating to cities, picking up menial jobs, because city also doesn't have job opportunities to absorb them. And this is where child labor comes in, where they are also employed to earn whatever little they can.
So if there is safe migration, then there is no problem. But that is not just migration, that is displacement, sometimes combined with trafficking. It is not simply the safe migration, will be people are looking for better life and better opportunities in cities and towns. Mm. That is uprooting, because we fail our farmers, we fail our poor sections of society at the village level. Mm. So we have to strengthen. Gandhiji fought for his whole life that we have to strengthen the economy of villages. We have to strengthen the economy of farmers and workers at village level. We have to ensure and guarantee all development scheme and social protection measures at the ground level in the villages, so that we should not face this curse of so-called migration, which is displacement.
So just to end, what would be, you know, the biggest challenge that you still see in front of you before we can actually achieve these, you know, targets of a safe and secure environment for children, where they are not bonded, where they are secure?
The biggest problem is still the social mindset. What we have seen in Varanasi, for example, the girls were abused. Naturally, the whole administration, the university administration and the district administration, should have taken it seriously. But when they made the complaints, the watchmen, instead of helping them, alleged and they blamed that, what are you doing here after 6 o'clock in the evening? So when the victims are stigmatized, when the victims are humiliated and abused instead of giving them fullest protection, that shows your mindset, the mindset of those people who were dealing with that cases. I never believe that any girl loses her dignity or her honor or her purity if the molestation or even rape is committed against her. So we have to fight with that mindset, this patriarchal mindset which blames the victims and protect the predators. So that is a big fight going on.
Sir, which would be the best global example that you think India can follow right now in this?
India can follow its own example. India had great potential. India has great talent. Our talent is shining everywhere in the world. Why can't we use that talent of India? India is known for morality and ideals and ethos. We have to go back to India to follow India.
All right, sir. On this note, thank you so much for sparing time for CNBC TV18. We wish you luck with this Bharat Yatra to make India really safe and secure for our children.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Archana ji.